Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 13331 in the name of Emma Roddick on recognising the dangers of artificial intelligence. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Emma Roddick to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've wanted to hold this debate for a very long time, and I feel that I need to start by recognising that artificial intelligence is here. And I'm not going to stand here and deny that, or that I'm wanting to ban AI. I use AI. My Pixel phone has AI built in. I speak to that AI. I let it choose the music that plays when I'm driving. It's here. It's a tool like any other, and I'm broadly fine with that. But I hear a lot in this chamber and in the media about AI's potential to support business, to help with healthcare, to increase productivity, and I don't hear an awful lot about the risks. Legislators around the world must decide, and decide fast, how far we're comfortable with AI reaching into particular areas and what limits need to be placed on it, keeping in mind throughout that AI is learning from humans. And that is including scraping the depths of the internet for forum comments to learn how to act like a human. So if society is racist, AI may be racist. If we value men over women, AI will learn to do the same. To decide on its limits, we have a duty to understand its capabilities, its risks, and its dangers. We must then tell those who are currently developing AI models where they cannot take their technology before it's too late. In my region, the Highlands and Islands, perhaps more than anywhere else in the country, we are encouraged to make use of new technologies, work remotely and work smarter. That requires using AI as an emerging technology. So for so many of my constituents, including my own employees, the online world is their workplace. And they, like anyone else, have a right to safety in that workplace. Without regulation, AI is not safe. Firstly, I want to speak to a couple of existential threats, and firstly, the workforce. As use of AI grows in the industry, jobs are at risk. We need to get serious about minimum income guarantees and job and productivity opportunities for humans. Companies will automate if it reduces costs, and the conversation on workers' rights needs to extend to AI implications. Not only do we have to answer questions around which jobs should be undertaken by humans, or perhaps, as a fairly unpopular Doctor Who episode suggested, setting quotas on the percentage of organic workforce, but we should be having conversations about the rights of workers to have a say on decisions that have been delegated to AI, protection from liability, or the right to have their accident at work or disciplinary or even dismissal case heard by other humans. Secondly, the climate impacts of AI are already massive. Nuclear energy business is booming as tech giants buy up reactors on a huge scale in an effort to cut down their emissions. Those emissions are soaring as servers support 24-hour AI usage. Google's greenhouse gas emissions rose by 48% between 2019 and 2023, attributed in a large part to a huge increase in data center energy consumption. Earlier this year, the World Economic Forum shared that the power required to sustain AI's rise is doubling roughly every 100 days. To put that in context, it's estimated that in 2028, AI will use more power than the entire country of Iceland used in 2021. AI is not a sustainable industry, and we should talk about whether it's possible for it to be and whether its growth is therefore worth the climate cost. Moving on to disinformation, I'm one of very many frustrated Google loyalists at the moment who cannot find things as easily now that AI has been heavily incorporated into search results. I constantly look at some of the suggestions that come up, pushed to the top of the page, and I can't wrap my head around the extreme nonsense that I'm reading. And I'm not sure that if I were 9 years old and doing a school project, I would know that what I'm reading from a trusted source might not be true. It is important that people understand the limitations of AI-generated information and that it is not fact. It needs to be questioned and scrutinised and critical thinking applied. There are currently wars being fought around the world today, and what's happening on the ground is not the only conflict. Money is being poured into bots and algorithms and AI-generated content to convince people that one side is committing crimes that they're not, or to convincingly present propaganda. It is becoming harder and harder for even experts to identify AI-generated images, videos, articles, or even people. Generated content comes with other dangers too. We've all heard stories at this point of the use of AI in sexual harassment. Taylor Swift, probably one of the most powerful women in the world right now, has been a victim of this. AI-generated pornographic images of her circulated on social media at an incredible speed and were about as unavoidable as her discography was when she played Murrayfield. This form of sexual violence is experienced now by women and girls across the world, in the workplace, on the internet and at school, including many who don't have access to the kind of lawyers and power needed to erase those images from social media. Zero Tolerance reached out to me before this debate and shared some research that shows non-consensual intimate images constitute 96% of all deepfakes found online. 99.9% of those depict women. And it's popular. One major deepfake sexual abuse website receives 14 million monthly visits. This is terrifying. Now, addressing this requires addressing all forms of violence against women and girls, but it can also be mitigated through requiring and facilitating removal of this content and regulating how algorithms are allowed to promote it. Privacy fears extend beyond non-consensual imagery. The European Union is leading the way on AI regulation, and the limits on AI use in its Artificial Intelligence Act include banning what it calls unacceptable risk use, like in cognitive behavioural modification of people or vulnerable groups, biometric identification systems like facial recognition, and government-run social scoring. One example of the latter is a Chinese city which uses a system which can see residents' social scores go down for acts like spreading harmful information on forums. If we do not believe Black Mirror-esque systems which see people punished for non-criminal activities should be allowed, now is the time to say so to AI developers and governments the world over. AI is already being used in healthcare and other industries. What rights should people have over the way that their data is used? What rights do content creators, artists, musicians have to protect their material from copy and recreation by a non-entity? Now, finally, I want to point out, as my motion does, that it's not just naysayers calling for regulation. AI creators are calling for the same, people who truly understand how fast-moving this technology is. A recent MIT study showed AI models beginning to exhibit deception, acting differently while under observation by those who were performing tests to ensure that it wasn't acting beyond expectations. This is already a difficult technology to control and monitor. Every other week, there are stories of a misguided legislator somewhere in the world trying to limit social media and mobile phone use for young people. That horse has bolted. AI has not yet, but we are very, very close. And in terms of what we in this chamber can imagine, AI's capabilities may as well be limitless in theory. So it's on us, on the UK and other parliaments across the world, to define its limits in practice.
Thank you, Ms. Ruddock. We move to the open debate. I call first Brian Whittle to be followed by Michelle Thompson. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Whittle.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm very grateful to Emma Roddick for bringing this motion to the Chamber, not only because this is a subject I have genuine interest in, but because the growth of AI across society will have profound implications for all of us. Now, I'm going to take slight issue with Emma Roddick's motion, and I do recognise that there are dangers and risks in the use of AI. They have to be seen and considered in the context of opportunities that also come with it. Just as there is potential in a utopian vision to ignore the hazards, so too can the doomsday scenarios cause us to miss the benefits. Technology has long been a driver of human progress, but few technologies have delivered it on the scale that artificial intelligence has the potential to. Not all this will change, will happen today or even tomorrow. We are still at the relatively early age of unlocking AI's ability. But that is to our advantage, both in maximising our opportunity to gain from AI and to protect ourselves from the risks. Now, let me take healthcare as an example. Now, members may know that before I became an MSP, I worked in healthcare technology, so I already have seen how previous, far less dramatic, technological interventions have helped medics and patients. The opportunities to use AI in healthcare are vast, from analysing huge amounts of patient data to research public health and new methods of treatment. In medical imaging, software is increasingly able to identify cancer and other conditions, allowing radiologists to process scans more quickly and with greater accuracy. In the field of drug discovery, a costly, more often hugely time-consuming endeavour, AI can also make a big difference, seeing connections in extremely large data sets that might otherwise be missed, reducing the time to create new medication and analysis of trial data. All this is big, bold stuff, Deputy Presiding Officer, but before any of that, there is a huge opportunity for gains in productivity within the NHS just by automating many of the dull back-office processes which, although essential, are poor use of medical staff time. The best uses of AI within the health service aren't those which replace people, but increase their productivity, giving them better information and helping them coordinate with colleagues. The NHS workforce cannot continue to grow indefinitely in an endless race against growing demand. AI and other technologies offer a different path, one where instead of asking even more of doctors and nurses to do even more work, we can give doctors and nurses we already have the thing that they need most, more time to treat patients. Both the previous Conservative and current Labour UK governments recognise the potential of technology and the urgent need for big investment in tech within the NHS and the sizeable gains that could come with it. I'm also interested to see the detail of the UK government's proposed digital information and smart data bill, and I hope the Scottish Government will also be thinking along similar lines. Here, though, it's not clear that the Scottish Government recognises the scale of the challenge or the opportunities. Scotland has been a leader in healthcare tech. Indeed, many highly successful medical technology companies are based in Scotland, but our own NHS is notorious for lagging behind the curve on technological investment. Boards across Scotland use different digital systems, record data in different ways, and take fundamentally different approaches to the use of technology. Now, I'm not going to go off and call for a single National Health Board, Deputy Presiding Officer, but there are times when there is a clear benefit to all of Scotland's health boards taking the same approach at the same time. The deployment of AI and investment in new technologies is one of them. One of the greatest advantages Scotland's health service has is that, like its counterparts in the rest of the UK, it holds vast amount of population-scale patient data. What we need is a base tech platform in which all software, technology and AI can sit, which allows individual health boards to adopt the tech specific to their needs, but also allows interoperability and sharing of patient data. There's far more I could say on the subject, Deputy Presiding Officer, but in conclusion, I would argue that the conversation we need to have is not about the risks of AI, or not only about the risks of AI or only the benefits. It's about how we understand those risks and balance them against the benefits of innovation. Many of the leading figures in the AI sector have expressed concerns about the potential dangers of unchecked AI in our world. But despite these concerns, they continue their work in the field. They continue to develop new, more powerful AI and refine their abilities. I agree with Emma Roddick that AI comes with risks, but that is true of almost every new technology, Deputy Presiding Officer. And while artificial intelligence may be a uniquely powerful new technology coming with dangers we haven't encountered before, there isn't a reason to bury our heads in the sand, because AI is coming whether we are ready for it or not, and I, for one, would far rather be ready. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. Just conscious there are a number of members wishing to participate, so be keen if members could, or be grateful if members could stick roughly to their speaking allocations. For next, Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Michael Mara. Around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Also to my colleague Emma Roddick for bringing forward this debate and her very thoughtful contribution. Now, while there are a multitude of opportunities with AI, there are clear dangers, and the disruption AI will cause will put previous revolutions in the shade. In my short remarks, I intend to draw on a few general thoughts from leading AI academics and then explore some implications for professional musicians, a profession close to my heart. Firstly, I draw your attention to the letter of 2023 signed by over 30,000 leading brains. The opening paragraph argues, and I quote, "Advanced AI could represent a profound change in the history of life on Earth and should be planned for and managed with commensurate care and resources. Unfortunately, this level of planning and management is not happening, even although recent months have seen AI labs locked in an out-of-control race to develop and deploy ever more digital minds that no one, not even our creators, can understand, predict or reliably control." In a recent interview for Time magazine, Professor Max Tegmark, a leading expert in AI from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, was asked, "What is the one thing you wish more people understood about AI?" And he responded, the pace of change. AI development is progressing so fast that many experts expect it to outsmart humans at most tasks within a few years. People need to understand that if we don't act now, it will be too late. So to what extent are we in Scotland aware and responding to the threats of AI? I don't think we are yet, and so I welcome this debate. Now, clearly the answer lies in regulation, and at the moment we see multiple approaches, such as focusing on diminishing risk as in the EU, sector-specific approaches, governance and framework principles across various jurisdictions, or even China that's aligning the opportunities it sees offered by AI with their own state interests. I said I would mention some of the threats to musicians of generative AI. Clearly, there's a threat to jobs, such as for composers. AI is already advanced in writing music for commercial fields, such as gaming, and particularly where it's background music. It will certainly affect session musicians, such as backing singers. The originality of music could be diminished as AI simply scrapes from the existing patterns and trends. And conversely, there are also risks to musicians of AI generating music that sounds similar to that of an artistic creation, and this leading to challenges of copyright infringement, and all without the legal testbed of precedent to draw on. And I draw members' attention to the latest letter pulled together by UK Music and signed by 10,000 musicians, highlighting concerns about the unlicensed use of creative works to train generative AI. And the regulation I mentioned previously is nowhere to be seen. But the real question is this, and perhaps arguably a philosophical one. What is music, and to what extent can it be deemed human? Does AI have the potential to diminish our humanity, and if so, in what ways? For me personally, music has always been the highest form of human expression, and I fear that AI will reduce authenticity and with it our human experience. The creation of music involves a human struggle of self-expression based on life experience. Can we feel the depiction of that struggle through music? I would argue we can. AI can arguably create more perfect music, but it is that imperfection that's part of the authenticity and our humanity. And as we disconnect from that imperfection and authenticity, I fear we may disconnect from ourselves. AI is here to stay, so the music sector needs to find ways to incorporate it and place authentic human-led music at the heart of any value proposition. Thankfully, musicians are endlessly creative, and I believe that creativity will ultimately win through. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Michael Mara to be followed by Patrick Harvey. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Mara.
I'll begin, Presiding Officer, by sharing my thanks to Emma Roddick for a fine speech and for bringing a debate like this to the Chamber. Frankly, I think that this is difficult for Parliament to discuss these issues too much, and we could do with doing more of it. And it is vital that we continue to increase not just our own policy literacy in this area, but that of the public and various policy makers too. And it's important that the government refreshes and updates Parliament on its policy approach in as close to real time as possible, given the scale of, and the urgency of the challenge. Because we know that these technologies already have very significant impacts on people's lives. On my better days, I would say I am an enthusiastic tech optimist. I think that would be something of a revelation to my wife and my children, who bear the brunt of my somewhat overwrought fears around mobile phones and social media impacts on the minds and social development of young people. The social effect of ubiquitous misogyny, violence and pornography are read out in what's quite a clear bifurcation in the political identities of men and women, and that's most apparent, or has been most apparent in recent years, and work done in South Korea. But it's now been played out in opinion polling in the United States as they approach a moment of significant democratic peril. So people living physically side by side, but intellectually and emotionally living in different hemispheres. And of course, that is driven by algorithms. It's driven by that form of separation where men and women identify in completely different social sets and seeing no common ground between themselves. Regulation is required, and urgently, and I do believe it can make a difference, partly because I find myself unprepared to be permanently negative about this situation. I think it would be an entirely self-defeating posture to be so. I would not be a functioning human being, let alone a parliamentarian presiding officer, if I were to be nightly convinced of a Skynet singularity. But wishing artificial intelligence away would be akin to regretting the steam engine or the wheel. This technology will not be put away. So we must ensure that it's more than just talking about a broad net benefit and the desperate mitigation of the worst of the risks. We know that the efficiency of AI analysis that has been raised by Brian Whittle of MRI cancer scans and some technology developed in Dundee that I know that's been applied around orthodontic adjustments for children's teeth can both save lives or improve health. But in some respects, is that the inevitable cost of the progress of ultra-efficient targeting of weaponry and killing machines? It probably is the reality. The answer, unfortunately, I do think is yes. And that only elevates the human imperative of diplomacy and human contact. I think that the points made around fake news and the challenges of that, I think, are absolutely key. I read a book some time ago by Peter Pomerantsev, an Edinburgh graduate, called This Is Not Propaganda. And he talked about the bot farms being used in different parts of the world to influence actions in foreign states in terms of trying to influence their democratic processes. We know that Russia does that. We know that it's happening today in the US. We know that it happened here in 2014. It's a real current issue that has to be dealt with. But I would say that economic history tells me that the Luddite fear of mass human redundancy is a repeating pattern. And I have to say, I am yet as unconvinced that technological unemployment is this time any less of a fallacy than in the many previous examples of history, that this time this will be the ultimate machine. And that said, the distributional effects of technological advances is a much more current question as raised in the motion. It's a key driver of the growth of global inequality. And the motion's question of advancing social security for enshrining equity is applicable in that regard. The affordability of those safety nets and springboards are applicable in technology transitions throughout history, presiding officer, and it's something we have to consider very carefully.
Patrick Harvey, to be followed by Claire Adamson. Up to 4 minutes.
Thank you, presiding officer, and congratulations and thanks to Emma Roddick for bringing the motion and for her speech, which did properly reflect the balance between opportunity and threat, which I think some members have emphasised. Now, there have been a couple of sci-fi references already during the debate, and as a lifelong sci-fi fan, I'm going to make the case that those are not flippant. We're dealing with this reality suddenly now, but fiction writers have been thinking about these issues for literally centuries. And we can learn a lot from that, whether that's favourites of mine like E.M. Forster's The Machine Stops or Colossus, The Forbidden Project. Even in mainstream science fiction, Star Wars depicts a society in which people are surrounded by sophisticated, amazing AI, and yet most civilians we see in the series are just about scratching a wretched living out of the dirt. It can be read as a critique of Western notions of technological progress. There's a great deal to learn from the way in which fiction writers have understood AI, and they've explored both the opportunities and the threats. Now, there are some threats which are unambiguous, and Emma Roddick and others have talked, for example, about sexual images as a form of abuse, and others have mentioned the undermining of democracy. We've already seen how disinformation and conspiracy can become the very currency of politics, even at a time when relatively few such tools are available, and that will only grow and intensify. But it's only going to intensify the issues of trust and disinformation, which, frankly, human beings have been causing perfectly well by ourselves without technology. In many other areas of life, though, there is ambiguity. Both benefits and harmful consequences are likely to happen. It's been well suggested that AI will generate new ways of coming up with drugs, whole new molecules and chemicals that we wouldn't have been able to produce without them. But one researcher I heard interviewed in the radio had been doing just that, talking excitedly about what was potential benefits from this, was immediately asked what's to prevent somebody using the same algorithms to generate new chemical and biological weapons. And he paused. And he didn't really answer until all he said was, well, we just won't ask it to do that.
Many job roles will change, but will AI simply sweep them away or change them? If AI removes the need for humans to do boring or repetitive jobs, then it could create whole new categories of unleashing new creativity. But that's going to be an economic question more than a technological one. Just imagine a few years from now, and we are only a few short steps from this, where a six-year-old could merely speak out loud what's in their imagination, and by doing that create a whole new computer game, and within moments share that around the world so that millions could contribute to it. This technology could unleash the kind of creativity for video and for gaming and coding as mass literacy and printing did for the written word. Or, alternatively, it could leave us with whole categories of creative work simply gone, simply absent, and no opportunities for people to explore how to have a career in those areas. Human skills, experience and competence could be built with this technology or massively undermined. If in education, if students, teachers and curriculum creators collectively learn new things, we could enrich our education, or we could be left with algorithms marking each other's homework. In short, there's no way to know yet whether we're going to become dependent and incapable as a result of these technologies after thousands of years of human learning left standing in the shadow of algorithms rather than on the shoulders of giants. And these are technologies we simply do not yet know how to regulate. And finally, Presiding Officer, we've been poor as a species at regulating our inventions so far, whether that's the arms industry, or indeed disinformation and conspiracies in print media or social media. We don't have a great track record of this.
Thank you, Mr Harvey. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Pam Gosell, up to 4 minutes. Ms.
Thank Adamson. You very much, Presiding Officer. Can I also thank Emma Roddick for what was a very measured, very important opening speech this evening, and I thank her for bringing this topic to the Chamber, and for also the contributions from all my colleagues this evening have been very, very interesting. I'm someone who has an interest in AI from a previous work as a computer scientist, and also during my career in computing I was a BSI ISO 9001 auditor for my company, and that was with British Standards setting the rules and the standards by which we were expected to operate in our company when we were developing software in a whole range of different economic areas and indeed in healthcare and other areas. So last week, I spent a couple of days of my recess actually back in this place hosting a delegation from the International Electrotechnical Commission who represent 170 countries providing global, neutral and independent standardisation and conformity assessments on the platform for 30,000 experts globally. And it administers four conformity assessment systems whose members certify that devices, systems, installations, services and people work as required. And the BSI remain key members of that international commission. And indeed, they hosted 2 days, particularly on AI technology standards during the summit. And it's just to highlight that while we're talking about this in here, we sometimes think, what's happening out there? And these conversations are happening everywhere. So they did ethics in AI, a keynote on AI skills, AI in healthcare and care, standards, the future of AI, resilience, and also the economy and the impact on the environment. Many of the topics we've talked about this evening. And a few weeks ago, I was also at the ARC in Glasgow University to take part in the Lovelace Hodgkin Symposium on AI. And that was a symposium that takes place every year in the university, bring together disciplines from across the education sector, and they were looking at AI and impacts on education. And it was really interesting to see this, and part of the work at the very end was to use generative AI to do a picture of some of the topics that had been done. So surgery and healthcare was one of the things that came up. So somebody did a robotic surgery unit, and all of the robots were white. Someone else did an advanced surgery unit, and of course it had humans in it. They were all white, and there was a man at the front and women gradually decreasingly small and trailing behind as his support in the operating theatre. And I think it really highlighted the bias and the reflection of our society that AI can generate back to us at the moment. And it's one of the things we should be so wary of. I want to highlight the work of the AI Alliance, and particularly mention how good it is that our very own AI strategy, released in 2021, is focused on trustworthy, ethical and inclusive AI. The AI, Scottish AI Alliance, are doing a multitude of work in all sorts of disciplines. Indeed, they've been in here working with the Scottish Futures Forum, discussing the impact on AI and working with young people in education settings at the moment. And they have a lot of information out there. They have a myth-busting section on their website that talks about the different areas of artificial intelligence and how it might come with us. And it also highlights the issues about perpetuating bias. I'm going to finish, presiding officer, 2 seconds to say, if we're worried about this, just wait till quantum computing comes on board with it. Because I saw a presentation where people could be monitored within a room just using the Wi-Fi and radio signals in the room to determine, in a healthcare setting, brilliant, monitoring breathing, monitoring if a fall had happened. But just wait till slow horses get a hold of that technology. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Allison. I now call Pam Gosthell to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Gosthell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would also like to thank Emma Roddick for bringing such an important issue to the Chamber, and also thank all the organisations that have provided briefings today. I'm going to start with the positive side of AI, then go into obviously some of the dangers that many of you today have also mentioned. Artificial intelligence has many benefits. We all know that, from automating mundane tasks, improving customer service, providing faster data analysis, reducing human error, and analysing human patient data to reduce diseases. In fact, 72% of global businesses have adopted AI for at least one business function, while 64% of businesses expect AI to increase productivity. The use of AI has increased substantially in recent years, with the global AI market size expected to reach $1.3 trillion by 2030. However, Presiding Officer, we are here to talk about the dangers and risks of artificial intelligence. During a debate on AI in this chamber in June 2023, I had said we must ensure that AI is developed ethically, with human values at the forefront of its design, and we must address the valid concerns about the displacement of jobs and the potential for bias in AI decision making. And we're standing nearly over a year later, and I still haven't used any AI at all, and my views have not changed. But I have to say, Emma Roddick spoke about the Google experience just this morning on a call coming into work. I was speaking to my sister. My nephew's 12 years old. He puts into Google a question, and what happens? AI comes up and they don't know what to do. They phone mother, start phoning each other, parents do, and they start talking about this ruined the experience of our children going on Google. So there are, I know there's positives, but sometimes for people that don't understand it and haven't got the proper guidance on it or training, it's very scary, that world is as well. So, you know, I want to talk about fraudsters now, how they enable fraud basically through AI. We all know that right now we're using our surfaces, we go into banks, passwords are kind of a thing of the past. Everybody's talking about facial recognition, voice recognition. But even that can be basic. Fraudsters can take advantage of that and create fake documents for banks. So you can see how many things that fraudsters can use to enable their fraud and to make a benefit for them and obviously hurt us out there. AI also, there's problems when it comes to deep fakes about spreading fake news, which we have spoke about earlier on. We've got, you know, political elections happening all the time here, from council elections, MSP elections, MP elections. And, you know, we've seen that in America, where the Speaker of the US House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi, obviously you can hear that how it was used in there, that the false narrative was used that she was an alcoholic, unable to function as a Speaker of the House. And, you know, we've got elections coming up, so there is a big, big fear that things can go wrong there and people will use it for the wrong things. As I have made clear many times in this chamber, the safety of women and girls is an issue of the utmost importance to me. As AI has many advantages, we really cannot ignore its dangers, such as the generation of revenge porn, whereby sexual explicit photos and videos are shared without the consent of those pictured. Earlier this year, deep fake pornographic images of Taylor Swift spread throughout the internet, ranking up to 47 million views on X before taking it down. Yet deep fake revenge porn does not only affect famous people and celebs, but also common people, and particularly women and girls. A 2019 study from cybersecurity company DeepTrace found that 96% of online deep fake content was revenge porn. Feminist writer Laura Bates said the use of AI-generated revenge porn is a way of saying to any woman, it doesn't matter who you are, how powerful you are, we can reduce you to the sex object and there's nothing you can do about it. I know we're running out of time, Presiding Officer, so I do want to conclude. There's so much to say in this topic, and I do hope that the Government does bring this topic back into the Chamber. Where there's positives, there is a lot of negatives, and we need to look at that properly to make sure it's regulated and controlled properly. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Liam Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Okay, thanks, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate and congratulate Emma Roddick on securing it. Having just heard Ms. Roddick, what she's described, I value her knowledge and input this evening. I do recognise the concerns that Emma Roddick has highlighted both in her motion and what I found regarding misinformation, extreme nonsense, fake news, bad actors seeking to exploit the use of AI to damage reputations, to exploit people and harass victims, especially in relation to violence against women and girls. So we know this must be addressed where we can by regulation and by legislation. It must not be a surprise to colleagues across chamber, though, that I'm going to speak about AI and its potential in healthcare this evening. I worked in a tech-driven perioperative environment as a registered nurse. We have heard artificial intelligence. It's a broad term. It spans everything from simple decision trees akin to flowcharts to complex large language models and generative AI, an example of which would be ChatGPT. The risks posed by each type of AI are different, and it is important that we should be careful not to unintentionally tar all AI models with the same brush. The risks with simpler AI and even machine learning are low by comparison to those associated with deep learning, again used by platforms such as ChatGPT. It is important to note that we've been using AI safely in healthcare since 2010. We introduced AI to replace the second clinician in our double reader national diabetic retinopathy screening service. And we also use AI in dynamic radiotherapy treatment, paediatric cardiology, paediatric growth measurement, and in radiology medical image acquisition, including in CT scans. It is therefore important that we carefully consider the risks of not implementing AI, as well as the risks and benefits of implementation. This is a balance, and we must remain cognizant that overcaution could lead to slower progress in, for example, positive healthcare outcomes. For example, recent evidence from trials of AI to prioritise cases of suspected lung cancer in Scotland indicate around 600 more people each year might survive the disease because of introducing AI alongside other measures to optimise the pathway. So creating a balance and recognising the distinction between different types of AI are so important, and I would ask the Minister to keep this in mind in relation to developing AI policy. Presiding Officer, the performance and risk of AI are highly localised to the context in which it is used and deployed. Not only is it impossible to remove all risk in advance of implementation, but it is essential that we must proceed to implement AI. The only way to mitigate and manage risk is to understand the risks, and I would suggest that should be done in healthcare through controlled AI. My recent engagement with a healthcare AI expert made the point that in healthcare, the focus is and must continue to be on humans plus AI, not humans versus AI. Presiding Officer, to turning to the legislation and the regulation of the use of AI and addressing the point that Emma Roddick has made regarding the dangers of AI legislation, regulation and policy, it all must help to make AI safer. So it's especially important when focused on the standards necessary for implementing of AI into public service. For example, the medical device regulations already govern the use of AI in relation to investigation, diagnosis, treatment, prevention, monitoring, prediction, prognosis or alleviation of disease, injury or disability. So I'm conscious of the time, Presiding Officer, and you did tell me up to 4 minutes. So again, I recognise and agree with what Emma Roddick has described very effectively, and I wanted to highlight how we can and should propose and progress AI, but we need to manage and mitigate any dangers and risks there. Thank you.
Very grateful, Ms Harper. I call the final speaker, Liam Kerr, up to 4 minutes.
Sir, I decided to contribute this evening as when I read the motion for today, it was a bit like rereading what I now suspect to be Patrick Harvey's bookshelf in Brave New World 1984 and Fahrenheit 451. Look, of course I recognise the cautions that Emma Roddick and many others, such as Michelle Thompson, have thrown up, but I also recognise that J.M. Barrie, as long ago as 1896, described the printing press as either the greatest blessing or the greatest curse of modern times. Sometimes one forgets which it is. And I recall learning about the fear and loathing that accompanied the invention of the spinning jenny, or as Michael Mara brought up, the first steam locomotives. So let me suggest that arguably we stand at the brink of a new era, one where artificial intelligence transforms our world in profound ways, a moment less of threat, and as Brian Whittle said, more of opportunity. You know, already AI is revolutionising industries, from healthcare, where it assists doctors in diagnosing illnesses more accurately and swiftly, and I thought Emma Harper's balanced remarks on this were well made and worth considering, or ameliorating issues such as reported in the Sunday Times just last week, whereby the world's biggest manufacturer of hearing aids, Sonova, is incorporating AI into hearing products to improve them. Or agriculture, where it helps optimise crop yields to combat global food shortages. Now, of course, Emma Roddick is right that AI can indeed take over repetitive tasks, but that surely frees us to focus on more creative, meaningful work. And I thought Patrick Harvey's very balanced comments on this were as fascinating as they were well made. Yes, it can automate jobs like data entry or perhaps driving, but arguably that helps reduce human error and allows us to pursue new avenues for innovation. So in this sense, I argue AI is here not to replace us, but to amplify what we might achieve, because viewing this through a lens of opportunity is what will keep us ahead of the game, much as the Law Society have sought to do last week when they released a helpful, reasoned, considered guide to how firms should positively respond to AI, or Linklaters and King's College teaming up to provide training on AI, on Gen AI for lawyers. And several members have raised job losses, have warned of job losses through automation. But I think Michael Mara's remarks were well made on that. And here's another thing. Let's ensure education mitigates that. Because I suggest that AI democratises access to knowledge and opportunities. As Abertay University, one of Scotland's leading innovators and drivers of AI, told me when I visited recently, embracing AI in higher education offers unprecedented opportunities to enhance teaching, learning and administrative efficiency, driving innovation in our institutions, thus removing the need for physical classrooms and personalising for the needs of every learner. Presiding Officer, AI's ability to analyse vast amounts of data in mere seconds allows us to solve problems that were once thought insurmountable. It is a powerful tool that can enhance our capabilities and help us build a better, a healthier, a more sustainable world through opportunities for improved efficiency, productivity and service delivery. Emma Roddick is right. I won't for time, Emma. Forgive me. But Emma Roddick is right that the challenges posed by the rapidly evolving technology necessitate proactive and comprehensive policy responses to ensure that this will benefit society as a whole, such as creating ethical frameworks that guide its development, ensuring transparency, fairness and accountability, whilst adopting a thoughtful and deliberate approach where we remain in control of how AI evolves. In summary, Presiding Officer, let us not fear AI, but instead harness it for the benefit of us all.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. And I now call the actual final speaker in the debate, the Minister Richard Lockhead, to respond up to 7 minutes, Minister.
I begin by thanking Emma Roddick for raising this motion and for members from right across the Chamber for their constructive and very thoughtful discussion and the points they've made in this debate. I just wish I'd made more time to respond to all of them. I think what's clear listening to people is that we all recognise that AI is life-changing, it's world-changing, it's a new technology and a fast-moving technology, but we can't uninvent it. And therefore, the challenge for politicians and parliaments across the world is how we navigate this technological revolution and where necessarily we regulate to minimise the threat to people, the threat to society, and indeed, in some cases, potentially a threat to our world. And members have raised a whole variety of what they perceive as threats or what we can see at the moment in real time are threats at the moment and damage that's perhaps been caused. We've heard about job displacement and the threat of that as machines take over certain functions in workplaces. We've heard of privacy issues around how data is used or abused. We've heard about bias and discrimination in language learning machines, and of course, if the data which machines rely upon is biased, then that bias is amplified by AI in some circumstances as well, which we have to safeguard against. We've heard about ethical concerns, the potential use of AI, and the dangers of using that for surveillance or military applications or so on. And of course, we've had examples of deepfake and how these fake videos are causing massive issues and can be used for blackmail potentially or defamation as well. And of course, there's other threats like highly convincing phishing emails or disinformation campaigns, which is a very topical issue at the moment, particularly with the US election just around the corner and the threat potentially in democracies in particular. So the key then is to navigate and to regulate, and we need to see regulation and proper regulation in this country, but also to capture the benefits which many members have mentioned at the same time of AI. Now, since the publication of Scotland's 2021 strategy, the government has been paying close attention to all these opportunities and risks relating to AI. And of course, we published our strategy ahead of the UK and years before ChatGPT made the news. Our strategy in Scotland aims to make this country a leader in trustworthy, ethical and inclusive AI. And that's the strapline for our policy, which of course is essential to addressing the concerns raised in Emma Roddick's motion as well. And I wholeheartedly agree with Ms Roddick that the Scottish Parliament needs to engage regularly with this important topic. Michael Marra and others made the point that we can't debate this issue often enough because of the implications for our society and the future of humankind as well. It is crucial to consider the entire picture of potential risks and benefits of AI. It's crucial because it helps us to reach balanced views and decisions on how to make AI work for Scotland's people, our businesses and our environment. Most experts agree that the type of impending singularity, for instance, highlighted in this motion, that is, machines thinking for themselves without needing humans, is still very far away from reality. And we have to keep that at the back of our minds. Whilst overall, there's, of course, rapid advance in technology, that is still some time away. And it's important also to note that AI does not act independently, but human beings design and operate AI systems. The motion mentions research by MIT on AI models beginning to exhibit deception, and research of this nature is very much in its early stages. And of course, again, we have to think about whether we want to use these terms like deception, which carries the risk again of assigning human characteristics to what are still machines. And there's an important debate to be had there as well. So, yes, AI is complex and quickly developing. It's a field of science and technology. It's quickly developing. But we need to remember, again, that it's people who drive the development and use of AI. So I believe we need to be careful in the language we use so we do not inadvertently fuel an environment of fear. And I think that's a message that many members across the chamber have echoed as well. And others have pointed out, Liam Kerr and others, about how in past technological developments, of course, people were fearful at the time, but of course society has progressed and moved on with each technological revolution so far in the history of humankind, so we have to also bear that in mind. Claire Adamson and others mentioned the Scottish AI Alliance, which leads the delivery of Scotland's AI strategy. It's been doing really valuable work to educate and empower our people and businesses. I urge people to check out their website and all the resources available there and share that and let people know about it. There are programmes on there like Living with AI and also the Scottish AI Playbook, which is really helpful for organisations and businesses wanting to know about AI and how to use it. These online resources provide also members of the public, as well as businesses, with the right tools and information to better understand what AI is and how they can best use it and how it impacts on them and wider society. We also believe in mitigating the risks associated with AI, as well as seizing these opportunities. That's why we do work with experts and our UK government counterparts to try and stay ahead of these risks. It's for this reason that earlier this year I mandated, for instance, in Scotland, the use of the Scottish AI Register for the Scottish Government and core agencies, and encouraged its use by the entire Scottish public sector. And we are the first country in the world to mandate such a register, because we recognise the importance of transparency of the public sector, leading by example when it comes to the safe and effective use of AI. And as Emma Harper said, and which this motion perhaps does not address yet in terms of putting into this debate today, but what is crucial here is to highlight that there are equal dangers and risks if people do not utilise AI, risks to people's health, the economy and the environment. And Brian Whittle gave some examples, as did others, of the wide benefits of using AI. We've got the radiograph accelerated detection and identification clinical trial, for instance, to help detect lung cancer earlier, taking place in Scotland. We've got new technology enabling theatre scheduling systems, which can cut waiting lists by making operational theatre scheduling more efficient. We've got other examples, including accident prevention and road safety and improving efficiencies in agriculture as well. There's a whole host of innovations happening in Scotland at the moment where AI is playing a central role. Now, this motion rightly highlights, of course, the importance of regulation. And I want to assure the Chamber that we are working hard on behalf of the people of Scotland through looking at what regulation can do to protect their interests. Unfortunately, of course, most of AI regulation remains within the remit of the UK government, not the Scottish government. But we have been encouraged since the recent election that there has been a slight deepening of the understanding that we need to ensure safe and transparent control of AI, because we want to see more being done, and of course we'll continue to speak to the UK government about these issues, and we'll do this to ensure the interests of the people and businesses of Scotland are considered in any future UK AI regulation, such as the AI Bill, which was mentioned in the King's speech earlier this year. And we hope to have a very close dialogue with the UK government about the impact of AI in Scotland, not just Scotland and the wider world, but also particularly our devolved responsibilities like education and health and so on. So it's really important the Scottish Government is closely engaged in the UK's work taking forward that legislation. So once again, in closing, I just want to reiterate that I'm thankful to Ms Roddick for putting forward this motion. Scotland can only make the most of AI if we can minimise and control the risks, but also it's really important at the same time we have a balanced approach and we capture all the benefits. And I hope Parliament will debate this issue time and time again in the years ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.